Thank you very much. First, I'm very happy. I want to say very happy to be here. I would like to thank the organizers for their invitation. Although I will try to be in the subject of the conference because this is not my main topic, stochastic control. So it will be mainly on numerics. And related to American option. The motivation of this work is to try to obtain higher order schemes for American options. And American options are modelized also by PDEs, which are kind of PDE for diffusion with an obstacle term. So this is diffusion equation with obstacle term. So the typical PDE I want to approximate is this one here. This is typically UT minus UXX equation, diffusion equation, and this is what I call an obstacle term. And I want to solve the minimum of these two terms is zero with an initial condition phi of x. So this is related to optimal stopping time problem. Before going on, I will denote A, U, this differential operator for commodity. And the link is the following, is that this value U is also the supremum cost of this expectation. So you have a probability space. Tau 0 t is the set of optimal stopping times, set of stopping times with values in OT plus measurable function with some measurability conditions. And the X, capital X, is a solution of the following SDE. So B is a drift term, sigma is a volatility term in a financial situation. And so sigma, as in the first talk, sigma is the wrong number that you put in the wrong equation to get the correct value in the end. But anyway, my problem is well posed in this way, corresponds to this financial problem. If you look at the solution of the PDE, so you look for a deterministic function U of T and X. The payoff function in a financial problem is typically this one. This is the American put option problem. So the payoff function is the maximum of k minus x and zero. We don't see very well. This is the black line here. And you look for the blue line. This is the solution u at some time t. And here the time, so I start with the payoff as initial data, and then I go backward in time. But here it is put in a forward way. So I have to solve this heat equation. And before going on, I want to say that, so in this equation, this is an obstacle term in the sense that this term must be positive, because the minimum of these two terms is zero, means that the two are positive and one of the two is zero. In particular, U has to be greater than phi, okay? So you are above phi. But the typical situation you see is that there is a part where you are really above the phi function. And here you are solving the diffusion equation. This is zero. And when there is a singular point here, and when before this point, you touch the payoff function. Okay, and U equals to phi, and the PDE, this part is greater than zero. And if I zoom a little bit, so this is a typical situation. I touch until some XS point, singular point, that may vary with the time, and then I am above here. So there is this paper where they, in particular, it is decomposed in this way. Furthermore, the kind of regularity you can expect is that the solution U is continuous. It is also in X, it is the first derivative is continuous, but the second derivative exists but is not bounded. So there is a jump in the second derivative of U with respect to x at this point. this is a problem, that the solution is not very regular. This is a problem in view of numerical methods also. The next thing is that in this paper, they show by some argument that the how behaves the singularity at initial time. So at t equals zero, you are on the payoff. And then the singularity which is there is going to move backward. And the behavior is like that. So you have k minus something which is in a, behaves like square root of t. So it goes fast. When t is small to zero, it goes fast away from the origin. This is a numerical difficulty. Okay, so you have a nonlinear PDE. You have this kind of regularity. So it's not so bad, but still it's not twice differentiable. And continuously twice differentiable. And you have these initial singularities, which is not good. Now, I'm not going to focus on this initial singularity. I would like to signal a work of Reisinger of Forsyth, where there is a preprint where they show that by doing a change of variable, this is a little trick, you can remove a little bit the singularity. So you have, numerically, it's also, you have to discretize well what's going on at t equals zero with respect with what you are doing in x. So you can do this kind of change of variable and it removes partly the singularity. But I want to focus on the non-linearity of the PDE and this kind of singularity after time t equals zero, how to deal with that. There is another PDE which is not well known. This is this was told to me by Robert Aymar. In fact, you can show that the price you are looking for satisfies ut greater than zero. So the derivative with respect to time is positive. So this is an increasing function for a given x. The function is increasing with time. And then you can show this other PDE, so the same diffusion part, but here you replace the obstacle term by ut simply. So the mean of the two is zero means that this one is zero, either this one or this one is zero, and the two are positive. So a priori, we'll see that it's important that the coefficients does not depend on the time, so that this is true. Okay, so once you write this, you see that the ut term can goes away from the minimum, so you get this equation, ut plus minimum of differential term and zero equals to zero. So this is more like more standard Hamilton-Jacobi equation, ut plus h of uxx equals zero with initial function phi. Sorry, there's an error, this is phi. So here you don't see the payoff function in the evolution equation. So when I first saw this I would like to recall these words of Schopenhauer. All truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. Third, it is accepted as being self-evident. And I first reacted in my mind a little bit like that. I thought it was wrong. It was completely wrong. And then I thought, no, it's not possible. I'm going to numerically test the thing and show him that's not working. He had a PhD student that made a thesis on that. So, but I was so opposed to that, and in the end, I did some numerics, and this PDE is correct, and but it's not so evident. I would like to give the idea of the proof. The proof is not difficult, but it's not straightforward. So first, so why do we have this other PDE? So first, by standard argument, I would say that we know that you have this property. If you take the value of the supremum cost, you can show this property. You have a semi-martingale property from which we can deduce this. And so why do we have ut is positive? So the way I wrote the definition of my value, I said it is equivalently given by the supremum, sorry, the g is the phi function, the payoff function, the supremum of all stopping time between 0 and t of this. So I take at time t plus h with positive h, I have this supremum over all stopping time. So this is a greater set than this set if you stopped at time t. So this is, you have this inequality, obvious inequality, and this is the price of u at time t. And so you get that these two terms are positive, the minimum of the two are positive. Okay? And so why it is zero? So assume that the first term is strictly positive, we have to show that this one is zero. So I assume that ut is strictly positive, then I assume also it is differentiable, to simplify. So then for h positive, you have ut is greater than u of t minus h. And this, you know that it is above the pair of function. So ut x is strictly above the pair of function. And then you can use a more standard argument to show that if you introduce the optimal stop in time, which is defined by this in this formulation, you can show that it cannot be t. And then from using a dynamic programming principle and Itô's formula, you can show that ut plus au is really zero. You are in the diffusion part. So if ut is strictly positive, you have the PDE part equals to zero. Hence, u is satisfying the second PDE. And since the PDE2 also you have uniqueness of viscosity solutions, so this is the solution of your problem. So you have a characterization by this second PDE. There is another point. When I look at this proof, I thought there was something wrong because I said, the coefficient shouldn't depend on the time. And we don't see where you need time dependency. In fact, they can depend on the time in this formulation, but this is not the financial formulation because here I'm starting from t equals zero and I go forward in time. So here you could have a time dependency to get equivalency here, but in the term of financial context, it means that you can have a time dependency with the remaining time to capital T. I think it's true, it looks true. Okay. An application of this second PDE. Now that you have a more standard Hamilton-Jacobi equation, this is also related to stochastic optimal control problem. You can formulate it like this. So you can introduce a stochastic control alpha, progressively measurable process with value almost everywhere in 0, 1. And 0 or 1, or the interval 0, 1. And you can, so here you see this as also as the minimum of sigma times AU for sigma between 0 and 1, alpha times AU, alpha between 0 and 1. And you get this equivalent formulation. So this is it's like a terminal optimal control problem with terminal time. And with x theta, 0 x alpha t is a solution of this PDE with alpha control alpha here between 0 and 1. You have a dynamic programming principle or martingale property that u at time tn plus 1 t plus h is given by u at time tn average this way. And so from this, you can also propose approximations. For instance, if you discretize by taking either alpha control equals to 0, means you take the zero part, or taking equal alpha to 1, purely diffusive part, you get the two extreme values, and you can approximate this value by the two extreme values, you get this maximum. And from here also, you see the link with some Markov chain approximations, these kind of things. So, okay. So we have these two PDEs. The second PDE is going to give me some insight in the analysis of why some schemes are working or not working, in fact. But in the end, I was not able to use the second PDE to get efficient schemes. So now it's more a deterministic world with finite difference schemes. I'm going to recall some basic finite difference schemes for one-dimensional problem in a space variable. Recall some efficient tools for solving implicit schemes in this context, and talk a little bit about the first-order barriers, why it's difficult to have better than first-order scheme. I start from this simplified obstacle problem to illustrate finite difference schemes. So there is sigma is 1, B0, no R. So here's the pure diffusion part with an obstacle term. I put boundary values. I assume directly boundary conditions on the obligam. I'm not going to talk about boundary conditions. So if you want to make a finite difference schemes, typically you introduce a mesh, xi, with, so it's a, here a uniform mesh with step size h, and you have also a uniform mesh in time tn equals n times tau, so h and tau are the mesh steps, and you look for u and I, which is an approximation of the v at tn and xi. So if you look at the first part, this is a typical finite difference scheme to approximate this part. It is consistent and with this term. And here, typically, it is a forward in time scheme, means that if you have been able to compute un at NTM and you want to compute un plus 1, so you look for a scheme for un plus 1, and this is logical to put this constraint on un plus 1. You demand that un plus 1 be greater than phi at xa. So I'm going to approximate this term like this. I put a constraint on the function that I want to compute, un plus 1. So un plus 1 should be solution of the vector of coordinates un plus 1 I should be solution of this system with boundary conditions. So you see that this is a minimum problem, so this is a nonlinear problem to solve. This is explicit scheme. So for the moment, it's explicit. Still, you have the un plus 1 in two parts. So how to solve in this un plus 1? This is explicit because here I put this time dependency. I put the n here. And in fact, it is explicit because you can multiply this. The mean of two terms is 0. You can multiply one of the two terms by a positive constant. So if I multiply this term by tau, I do not change the PDE. The equation, sorry. So the tau, I multiply here by tau, and then I can put outside the un plus 1 I here, and again, un plus 1 I is equal to an explicit formula. And you get the maximum of these two terms. This is the explicit Euler scheme for, forward Euler scheme for diffusion equation, and you have to maximize with a pair of value. What about the stability of the scheme? What can we say? So I start from the linear case equation. This is the scheme multiplied by tau. You see that un plus 1 is a combination of these three values with this constant k, is tau over h square. And so I denote this evaluation sun. So if k is positive and 2k is smaller than 1, you get a convex combination. You get some stability. So what can we say? Indeed, if 2k is smaller than 1 and positive, you can show that you have this L infinity bound. The supremum of un plus 1i is smaller than the supremum of un I. And for the consistency, by construction, you see that if you put the exact solution and you assume it's regular, you get that this difference, or this is one way to see the consistency, this term should be like the PDE plus small remaining term. So this is the consistency error, and it is of order tau plus h squared. Okay. So we said it is first order in time and second order in space, typically. However, because of this CFL condition, tau must be of the order of h squared, so this is also of the order of tau. It's not very efficient. So the problem I want to address here in this talk is how to get a tau square here. If I get a tau square, you change from first order scheme to second order scheme. So you see this is really more efficient if you in terms of CPU time, precision, etc. If I want to get rid of the CFL condition, this condition, which we call Conrad-Friedrich-Levy condition, I have to go to implicit schemes. So here, implicit schemes mean I take the same thing, which is going to be consistent, but I put un plus 1 here instead of un. So solving this equation in un plus 1 is a linear problem. So it's not explicit, but it's still linear. Here you have a matrix A, where after multiplication by tau, you see the coefficient appearing 1 plus, there is an error, I think, somewhere. So it should have 1 plus 2k, I think it's plus and minus here. And you see 1 plus 2k on the diagonal, minus k on the first over and subdiagonal of A. And you have to solve A un plus 1 equals un with this thing. And consistency is the same. But for stability, it's better because you see that A is diagonal dominant with this term is greater than the sum of the other term in the line with a gap of 1. So then you have an estimate. In L infinity norm, A to the minus 1 is smaller than 1 over delta equals 1. So you get this is bounded by 1, and you get this stability. Good. So now what about the true nonlinear case? I want to solve this nonlinear scheme. So this is really now an implicit scheme. You have an implicit equation of in terms of un plus 1. We multiply by tau, and we put that in matrix form. So we after multiplication by tau, you see again the matrix AU that appears. You get minimum of AUn plus 1 minus non-vector, un plus 1 minus phi of xi equals 0. I will denote gi the value phi of xi. I will also note this problem as follows. So we look for x solution of this problem, minimum of ax minus b, x minus g equals 0, component by component wise. Okay. So eventually, I will remove the I and x. So this is the minimum of two vectors must be 0. This is also known as the obstacle problem, complementary problem. Then you can show, for instance, if the diagonal of A is positive, which is the case here, if it is delta greater than, if it is diagonal dominant, then there is existence and uniqueness of solution of this. Moreover, you have this stability result with this assumption. So there is no more CFL condition, and you have solutions. From the practical point of view, it's not obvious to solve this. And in fact, there have been tools developed by motivated by in finance by the financial problem. This problem is also known as the linear complementary problem when g is 0. Even if g is not 0, you can make a translation and go back to the case where g is 0. There is a result in the 70s where you know that for any b, there is this only one solution of this problem if A is a P matrix, means that all principal minors are positive, strictly. There are also recent results based on simpler results based on the eigenvalues of A to get existence of uniqueness. However, from the practical point of view, numerical point of view, there have been several approaches. I give some of them. There is the PSOA approach, which is a relaxation approach to solve this problem. So if L was lower triangular with the positive diagonal, you could solve it by a descent method. If A is not diagonal, you can use a kind of relaxation method. You decompose A into L plus U, and you do an iterative algorithm. But this is an iterative method, so it's slow to converge. And you have to solve this problem at each time step to get an approximation of the function for any time. Another algorithm, well-known algorithm, is called the Brennan-Schwarz algorithm. It's based on a UL decomposition of A, like LU decomposition with three diagonal upper, diagonal lower matrices. And another method is, in fact, Newton's method. You can attempt to solve this by Newton, nonlinear equation. And there are also approximation methods by splitting. So you instead of solving this equals 0, you solve the two of them, and you take the maximum of the two. But this generates an approximation, so this is not what I want. I'm going to give some results concerning these two approaches. First, the Brennan-Schwarz, then the Newton approach. So the problem is to solve this. The Brennan-Schwarz approach, one way to see it, even if it's not presented like this in general, is to decompose A into lower, upper and lower tridiagonal matrices, if A is tridiagonal. And so this is the problem you want to solve. A is the UL matrix. Assume this equivalence is true. So if we could multiply this by U minus 1, the matrix, you would get this system with L lower triangular. So you can solve this by a descent method. And basically, solving this is the Brennan-Schwarz method. If you have tridiagonal matrix, you have an efficient method. You have a linear cost in terms of size of the system. The thing is this true? Yes, this is true for solution with some profile. The profile is that you have to touch the payoff function, and then you have to be above the payoff function. So if you know that the solution you are looking for have this behavior, then this is okay, and this is very fast and efficient. However, if you don't have this behavior, so if you had something like that to solve, you have an obstacle like that, so you may have a solution which is, I don't know, like that, maybe. Then here it will not work. It works only in some parts, this UL approach. This is elementary calculus, not difficult to understand, but not in the focus of the talk. So, okay, so now I switch to Newton's algorithm. In fact, it is we can apply what is called a Smith-Moos-Newton's method, because the function is not regular, but it is almost everywhere differentiable. You can show that this minimum function is slightly differentiable, so you get local convergence and you have some results for slightly differentiable functions. But for the obstacle problem, we have even better. I want to give the result. So you define this minimum function. You define the derivative as follows. So if these two terms are different, the derivative is either the derivative of this term or this one. So there's no problem. So if the derivative of this is Aij for this matrix. Otherwise, is identity Ij. But in case of equality, we choose this definition. Then you have a very efficient scheme. Newton's algorithm is given by this. This is also motivated. Why trying to solve this by a Newton method? This is also motivated when you want to solve more general stochastic control problems. For instance, Merton's portfolio problem. You have this kind of problems with some SDE. You show an Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation of this form. And when you want to implement an implicit finite difference scheme, you are led to this kind of problems, more or less in the same way. So here we have only two controls, which is either you diffuse or you do nothing. But more generally, you can have a set of controls in some compact. And there are some results also for the Newton's algorithm for this. Definition, if B is a monotone matrix, we say that B is a monotone matrix if the inverse is positive component-wise or this equation. We say also that B is an M matrix. In this talk, I will say that B is an M matrix if the diagonal is diagonal dominant with positive diagonal, negative of diagonal elements. And M matrices are monotone matrices in particular. And I'm going to define mixed matrices. So it's matrices BA, where you take a line of A or a line of identity, whether AI is 0 or AI equals 1. So this is, and I'll define also the BA vector, which is BI or GI, depending on this control parameter. Then you can reformulate the minimum of these two vectors like that. This is more like a minimum of a, so for each component, you choose to be at left or right. And when you want to solve this equal to 0, there is something called Howard's algorithm in control with results, with convergence results. The main assumptions to make is that BA is a monotone matrix for any A. So if you mix matrix A and matrix identity line by line, you choose one line of A, either one line of identity. You look at all possible combinations, and you assume that all these matrices are monotone. For instance, if A is an M matrix, the mixing with identity has this monotony assumption. satisfies this assumption, then you have a convergence result. So it goes back to Howard's algorithm. In fact, Newton's algorithm and Howard's algorithm are equivalent. They give the same iterates. And there have been some extensions in the case you minimize over a set of compact controls. So there is existence and uniqueness with this assumption. You can show that the iterates produced by the Newton's method are increasing pointwisely. And from this, you get convergence. And also, for the minimum problem, for the obstacle problem, you show that there is convergence in at most 2 to the j iterations. Furthermore, if you look carefully, you can see that for the specific obstacle problem, you have an improvement. The convergence is in at most j iterations because the controls, the choice you make, which line I have to choose, in fact, there is a monotony in this choice, and so you have to you will have at most j iterations. Moreover, there is another more precise application of this, which is given in this work, that if you look at the total number of Newton's iterations that you need from when you solve all the implicit schemes for all times between 0 and capital T for your implicit schemes, so not only from un from to un plus 1, but un u0 to u capital N, you can show that the total number of Newton's iterations is bounded by the number of mesh points. The reason is that the number of iterations needed by Newton's method between un and un plus 1 is bounded by the number of points that take off the thing. So I'm going to zoom a little bit. You have here, suppose you have your function un, okay, like that. So this is un I values. Then at the next time step, you may have, for instance, this, and then you go like that. Okay, this is un plus 1 I values. Then this is the points that, these 2 points, they took off the pair of function, and the number of iterations for Newton's methods is limited by 2 in that case. So in the end, you get a bound like that. So that makes, you have a rigorous bound of the total of number of iterates in this Newton's method. So in the end, for 3 diagonal matrices, doing these implicit things is not very costly, it's very efficient. So we have this efficient tool to solve implicit schemes. However, we are still first order in time. So we want to improve the precision in time from O of t to O of t2, t squared. There are some theorems that tells you that you cannot go to higher order if you look for monotone schemes. In general, you want to look for monotone schemes because you want monotony to get convergence to the viscosity solution. For instance, Barrel-Souganidis theorem, error estimate, usually you need monotony of the schemes. But if you take simply an advection equation, ut plus ux equals 0, or bux equals 0, if you look for a linear scheme like that, with positive coefficients to get monotony of the scheme, you can show that you are limited to at most first order schemes. For other reasons, I will talk a little bit about this. For nonlinear diffusion problems, you have also some limitations, and although this has to be precise in some sense, but for these reasons, we are led to try implicit schemes, okay? There exist higher order schemes by using Markov approximations, but not if we really discretize mesh in time and space. Alors, let us try a well-known scheme, the Kronk-Nicholson scheme. Kronk-Nicholson scheme is you discretize the A operator, you make an average between un and un plus 1. Okay, instead, un is the explicit scheme, un plus 1 is implicit, and you put that approximation, and you put the obstacle term here, and you want to solve this. Okay, you see that if you can multiply by tau here, you have the factor of un plus 1 is identity plus a tau over 2. You still have an M matrix, and we can solve this by Newton's algorithm efficiently. However, numerical experiments show that using tau, the time step of the same order as h, you get stability, second order. So it looks, it works well. But if you take a larger time step, because you don't want to make too much time steps, it is costly, you switch to first order. So it's not very robust. So I remember this is two, observation A, observation B. Why do we switch to first order? What is wrong? Let us make a consistency analysis. Consistency analysis is you look for a regular solution, how your approximation is close to the true PDE. So you take this thing. Alors, this is an approximation of Vt at time tn plus 1/2 with order tau square. And this is centered approximation for the first derivative. And this is also a good approximation at the midpoint in time tn plus 1/2. So we get Vt minus Vxx at tn plus 1/2 plus this second order approximation. So this is a good approximation, Kronk-Nicolson scheme, at tn plus 1/2. And then you put that in the obstacle scheme, so you get that the obstacle S1 is this minimum, is this term plus the obstacle term. And so you can put this out of the mean, which is one Lipschitz. However, we cannot assume that Vt minus Vxx is zero, because Vt is not solution of this PDE. Vt is solution of the obstacle problem. And this, in particular, where you have the singularity. And here, the times are different, n plus 1/2, n plus 1. So if you want to have the same times to go back to the PDE, you are going to have an error in tau. So even if you have this, if you switch from n plus 1/2 to n plus 1, and you compensate, you get some term here, you get an error in tau, because Vt is not equal to Vxx. And this is so I was misled, because for a long time I didn't saw that. So it's not consistent. If you take the Kronk-Nicolson scheme, this way to put the obstacle term, it gives a non-high-order consistency scheme in general. So then we do not understand why it is second order numerically. We understand why it is only first order. I would like also to emphasize the fact that even if you take a very high-order approximation for diffusion equation in that sense, with h squared and tau to the q, or 2 squared, if you have even an exact scheme for the advection for the diffusion equation, like Wick-Taylor schemes, Platten scheme, Claudel and Platten, assume you have a high-order scheme. You take the max scheme for the obstacle equation, you maximize with the payoff this exact scheme. Equivalently, you can write it in this way, un plus 1 minus s over tau, un plus 1 j equals zero. And you can show in the same way that this is not high order in time. You have a switch, and because you have this consistency, not the consistency at time tn plus 1. And so there is a little problem here. Still we don't understand why the CM scheme is of second order sometimes. I come back to the second PDE. The second PDE, remember that you have a UT term in the second position. Now, look at this second scheme. You discretize the second PDE, like CN scheme, but here I put this second order approximation of UT at time tn plus 1/2. So this new scheme is second order in time consistent at this time. But this is okay. So this is a true second order consistent. We do numerics. Tau equals h is stable, it's second order, but it should be second order. Using tau equals 10 h, you switch again to first order. It's better, but it still switch to first order. So what's going on? In fact, we can understand a little bit. You can see that if you take the first scheme for PDE1, if the solution you are computing is above the UN, if you have a monotony in the solution you compute, in the first scheme, the constraint is to be above the obstacle function, not to have this increasing thing. But if it happens that the scheme produces this, then un plus 1 is also solution of the second scheme, with un plus 1 minus un. So then both schemes give identical values. So the first scheme is equivalent to the second scheme, which is second order in time. So we can understand like that the second order behavior. Why do we switch back to first order? Is because, this is the case. If you have a CFL condition, you can show that, you can really show that this happens if the tau is not too high. But if tau is high, the CN scheme has some stability, but it has some oscillation bad behavior. And so we observe the loss of the second order behavior because I think the CN scheme doesn't have very nice stability behavior for bad CFL numbers. So we have to propose something. So this is the scheme in 5 minutes. But the scheme is, in the end, there's lots of discussion, but in the end, the scheme is very easy, it's very efficient. And now we have the tools to compute and to explain. The idea is to use a BDF scheme. And this, the idea is that you approximate the derivative with this backward difference formula. You have Vn plus 1, Vn, and Vn minus 1. This is a second order approximation. You inject that into the scheme. You don't touch the diffusion part and keep the obstacle term. So this is high order at Tn plus 1. So there is no problem to get second order consistency at Tn plus 1. So we are going to solve this. At least it is second order consistent. No question about that. It is a multi-step scheme. It means that you have to initialize U0 and U1 to start computing U2. And then you need the two previous values. For this part, this is known also as the GS scheme. And I recently discovered that, in fact, it was already proposed by Osterli in 2003 to get in 2D with some ID with 2D problems. So the gain here that we really show precisely that it is second order. This is a good scheme also. We are able to prove convergence and a stability estimate. And this is the difficult thing to have. This is a completely non-monotone scheme for which you have a rigorous stability estimate. So if you have regularity, if it is second order consistent, you get second order convergence. However, the solution is not so regular, so it's more difficult to get convergence. However, we can still show convergence of lesser order. But having a scheme that you can implement that is numerically second order and for which you have a stability estimate was not obvious at all. So this is the small contribution that we made with Christian de Brabant. So by construction, you have second order. It is implementable because you multiply by tau, you have this mean problem. So this is an obstacle problem to solve, where here this is an M matrix. And so we can solve it efficiently. The scheme has some known stability properties. In fact, for linear PDEs, it has been studied. So you can show that the scheme is A stable. But if you try higher order schemes in the same way, they don't have this nice stability. So this particular BDF2 scheme has a nice stability property. The stability property is when you look to the discretization of this ODE, you want the solution should be stable when the real part of lambda is negative, and you want to find that on the scheme. And for BDF2, this is the value of lambda in the complex plane, and the pink region is where the scheme is stable. So you have for all real parts negative, you have stability of the scheme. If you try higher order BDF schemes, this is for k equals 2. For k equals 3, you have a little region where it is not stable, but it's almost A-stable. And if you do numerics, you see that it is stable for tau equals h, second order, but also for tau equals 10 h, or very large number. So it is really unconditionally stable, and you observe really numerically second order, and it's very efficient. There is a convergence result. I'm not going into details, but you can compare the obstacle equation with the perturbed equation. You want to stability to to show some error estimate within the two, with some consistency error here. You can show this kind of estimate, some estimate that you can find for parabolic equations. So it holds for this completely non-monotone scheme. And assuming the regularity that Vxx and Vt are bounded, they may not, you may have a jump in Vt on Vxx, but you assume that they are bounded, you can show that the, you can show an explicit bound on the consistency error in L2 norm. You're not working in L infinity norm, but in L2 norm, this is bounded, and in the end, you get H to 1/2 bound. So you have a second order scheme, numerically second order. You can prove this estimate in L2 norm, and you have a stability estimate on the scheme. I'm going to skip this proof, but the trick is was to be able to go back to the classical stability proof for BDF2 scheme, and that is working for obstacle problem. That is, and okay. Some numerical examples. Another good, interesting point in this work, I think, is that we, since it's very, you don't have numerical analytic solution for the American problem, and it's difficult to find in papers values or reference solutions. So we made ourselves some reference problem with a F function. So we construct a problem with a singular behavior. We construct an explicit solution which behaves like the American option, and we inject the V, our V, into this thing to get a second term F, a source term, and then we try to solve this. Okay. Also, okay, and we have made two models: once with a second derivative bounded, another one with a more regular switch between this at this point, to test higher order BDF schemes. And so the two models, you don't see anything with the eye. This is the second model. If you try Conti-Colson scheme with tau equals h, you get typically second order convergence. So you look how the error decreases when you double the number of mesh steps. But if you take bad CFL numbers, tau is greater than h, you switch back to first order. And even if you take the second PDE Conti-Colson scheme that is a priori second order, you start to switch back to first order for large CFL numbers. For BDF2 scheme, you see second order. Or it's not everywhere second order, but this is in infinity error, it's almost second order. LN1 and 2, you observe second order numerically, so it's efficient. So you can go to here, it's up to 10 to the minus 5. So to get that, we first test everything where you have the exact analytic solution to be secure, and then for this one, this is a true American option. We compute with the scheme with very precise match, two, three step forwards, a reference solution, and we compare our results to the reference solution. But we have first to compare with an explicit solution because it was, we were in the unknown. We try also BDF3 implicit scheme like that with a higher order approximation for the diffusion part, a smoother initial data, so we switch the time to a little bit greater to avoid the initial singularity, and doing all that, the BDF2 is still second order, the BDF3 is not third order if you don't work, but doing a smoother initial data and fourth order spatial approximation, we can observe with BDF3, we can also observe third order, even if we don't have convergence proof for this. My conclusion is, there are two slides for the conclusions. Is I want to compare our results in terms, so what is the precision you can obtain, epsilon, in terms of number of operations of the algorithm. I'm going to compare our algorithm with a recent result of Lamberton. And then I will go to the real conclusion. So for our BDF2 scheme, the number of operations is proportional to number of time steps, and at each time steps you have a cost which is proportional to J, in fact, because you solve one or two times the implicit scheme, and so it's bounded by J, times some constants. So if you take n equals to J, you get n squared. operations. And the error you observe is in two square. Tau is h is the same, so you get 1 over n opt. So the error is in 1 over n opt operation, while the theoretical error bound is this one. If you compare with the tree method, recently Lamberton was able to obtain for a kind of Markov chain approximation in the constant coefficient case, I think it's only working in particular cases, with a tree method with n levels. So you start with you compute the pair function at n points, and you go backwards to compute to estimate one value. The number of operations is like n squared to some constant, and the error, observe the error, is 1 over n. So you get 1 over square root of n opt. It's less efficient. However, he was able to obtain a theoretical boon, so both sides estimates in log n to the alpha over n. So it's close to the optimal estimate for this tree method. So some ongoing works. There's also, we are trying to implement discontinuous galactic approaches, which are efficient methods, so for cycle problem. And more generally, when you have nonlinear Hamilton-Jacobi equations, we would like to generalize this approach to implicit schemes for these problems. Cool. Thank you very much for your attention.